So we have some wonderful esteemed speakers today. Last we will be hearing, but most importantly, from Emil Fisch, who is a survivor of the Holocaust. And I can't tell you how indebted we are that you've traveled from New York to be with us today to share your stories of what happened to you and your family and to millions of other people, Jewish people, under the horrors of the Nazi regime in the 1930s and 40s. With him is Dr. Shai Pilnik, who is the head of the Yeshiva University Holocaust and Genocide Studies Department. Okay. Thank you.
And Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Yeshiva University.
Yeah.
Named after
Emil Fisch.
His late wife, Jane. Yeah.
But first, I will hand over to Mark Cave, who is the chief executive of the National Holocaust Memorial Center in the UK. Thank you, Mark.
Moira Mutze. Did I say that right? Well, you're smiling, so something's good. Hello, everybody. Thank you, James, for having me and Georgina. I'm going to just give you some introduction to a relationship that you may not know about between this amazing place and a place in England. And the common factor is James and his family. The Smith family in 1995, as all the terrible things were happening here, were busy devoting all of their energies to Britain's first and still only permanent Holocaust memorial site and museum. They're not Jewish. The Holocaust is a Jewish phenomenon, as I'm sure you know. And what that says about good citizenship and neighborliness and empathy and respect for someone else's identity is incredible. So in then deciding to try and help mend relationships and heal and educate and learn here in Rwanda, it's the same ethos, the same approach, although of course the circumstances are very different. And I really want, actually, and it's not why he asked me to speak, because he doesn't know I'm going to say this. I want to pay tribute to James and to Freddie and all of their colleagues for the amazing work that they do here, because I know how hard it is to, I've taken over the responsibility for the English institution that James and his family set up, and it's a hard battle to preserve and to respect someone else's identity without it feeling like a threat to your own. And for me, that is the battle, that is the challenge. And it's especially hard when we have social media every second of every hour of every day, all the time, feeding us with misinformation and disinformation. So the importance of being able to think critically about not just the what of a genocide, but the why is really important. So I'll leave it there, but what I thought I might do is show you a film, it's a 10-minute film, which explains the origins of the English National Holocaust Museum that James and his family set up, and its connection to the Kigali Memorial. So if someone could press play, that would be great, and thank you.
It's just too vast to actually put it in a few words. I couldn't do it. I was there 8 months and witnessed the destruction day in, day out.
I'm just so fortunate to be alive. You know, I'm one of the few, so few of us survived.
I've suffered I don't want you to suffer in the same way. I want to feel that by telling my story that you can do something about preventing a future genocide, a future Holocaust.
The horrors of the Holocaust only become real when you hear an individual's story, as it did for me when I was filming in what is now Belarus. I heard the story of my great uncle Abraham, who committed suicide in 1942, just days after discovering that the Nazis had murdered his two-year-old daughter. And I visited the site of a synagogue where my great-grandparents had been burned alive while they worshipped. The suffering that resulted from such hatred and prejudice must never be forgotten. The National Holocaust Centre keeps the memory of these events alive every day. The centre was built by a non-Jewish family who believed that the Holocaust has lessons for us all.
There needed to be somewhere to visit and remember the Holocaust, but there was nowhere in the UK.
Before we could even begin, we realised that we needed to know about the history of the Holocaust. What happened, to whom, when and how. Such knowledge is the basis of learning.
The swastika, symbol of Nazi power and anti-Semitism. But we are no strangers to anti-Semitism in Britain either. The ultimate expulsion of the Jews from England in 1290 shows just how far back the roots of hatred lie in European history. Jews were seen as outsiders, pariahs, the other. Following Germany's defeat in the First World War, a sense of national humiliation led many, including a young Adolf Hitler, to seek extreme solutions. By 1924, he had unsuccessfully led a coup d'état in Bavaria and was behind bars, from where he wrote his political manifesto, Mein Kampf.
Heil! 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 Heil!
In 1933, when Hitler came to power, it was by popular vote. The German people themselves made choices that ultimately led towards mass atrocities.
It was a slow process, which began with an anti-Jewish boycott on the 1st of April 1933. Political opponents were silenced in concentration camps in large numbers. Gypsies, homosexuals, trade unionists, the disabled, and Jehovah's Witnesses among its many victims.
We always have to remember that the Third Reich was conceived as a utopian state. The pursuit of the master race came before everything else, and anybody else who did not fit that type was to be removed.
In 1935, the Nuremberg Laws were introduced, detailing who could and could not be a citizen of the Third Reich. Jews, including those of mixed descent, were stripped of their rights and mercilessly humiliated. And so daily, the pressure to leave grew.
The Jews wanted to leave Germany, but no one wanted these refugees, and quite simply, they had nowhere to go. They were trapped.
Kristallnacht, the Night of Broken Glass, was a defining moment. On the 9th of November 1938, 91 Jews were killed, hundreds of synagogues were burned, and tens of thousands of Jewish men were taken to Dachau and Buchenwald. Now anything was possible. The outbreak of the Second World War meant that the Nazis were occupying territories with millions of Jews in them.
Wherever the Nazis occupied new territories, they immediately imposed their race laws, dehumanizing the entire Jewish population.
Then, a series of ghettos were established in which hundreds of thousands of Jews were crammed into impossible spaces, resulting in overcrowding, disease, and starvation. The policy to allow these people to slowly die was deliberate. The ration in the Warsaw ghetto, just 240 calories per day.
250,000 Jews were living there when the Nazis occupied it in June 1941. By December, 1,000 were still alive.
Within weeks, the Nazi hierarchy created the so-called final solution of the Jewish question.
The Nazis created 6 death camps in Poland: Chełmno, Majdanek, Treblinka, Belzec, Sobibor, and Auschwitz-Birkenau. The killing had only just begun.
Some deportees were exploited in terrifying conditions as slaves for the war effort. The rest were immediately sent to their deaths. By May 1945, an estimated 6 million Jews were dead, 2/3 of the entire population of European Jewry. In addition, millions of others had been murdered because of their identity. The Nazis left behind a scene of carnage which defied belief.
They had no family, no home, no education, no country, no past, no future. They had survived, but what were these people to do with their lives?
Their eyes had probably seen the most horrific chapter of European history ever.
In 1991, James and I visited Yad Vashem, the Holocaust Memorial in Jerusalem. It was a very moving day. It was also very challenging. I suppose it was the day that changed our lives.
We wanted to know why it was not only that we hadn't learned about the Holocaust at school, but what does this mean to us as people and the world in which we live? Clearly, you can't blame a handful of Nazis for the scale of what happened. You need to have the collusion of vast sectors of society.
Oh, nice to see you.
The brothers approached their mother, Marina, who was running a retreat near Laxton, Nottinghamshire, and asked if they could have a couple of rooms to establish a small resource centre for teachers and students. But before they went ahead, they visited some of the sites of the Holocaust in Central and Eastern Europe.
I remember driving through the Polish countryside, one town after the next village, where there had been 1,000 years of Polish Jewish history and heritage, and we found nothing, nobody more to the point. And so we asked ourselves a question: what do we have to do to ensure that they are not forgotten?
Over a 4-year period, the project came into being.
There was this car outside, and out jumped some young chap that I'd never seen. He said, well, you're one of the survivors, aren't you? And I've come to see you because I am going to open a Holocaust centre. And my husband was there, and we both laughed. We looked at one another and laughed. And I said, well, that's a very noble idea, Stephen, but you're not going to make it. Lots and lots of people have tried and failed, and I've been to hundreds of meetings and nothing's happened. He said, you wait. When the centre opened, I was gobsmacked. I really was, you know. It was just amazing. I couldn't believe it. It was just an amazing sight.
I heard them say, the night is past, brighter skies are here. But even in the light of day, I can hear you calling, calling.
Called Beth Shalom, meaning House of Peace, the centre opened in 1995 as a place of remembrance for victims of the Holocaust and a place of learning to work towards a world with less needless bloodshed.
So hearing him talk about an individual story, I actually appreciate that through the atrocities, the people are not just figures, they're actual people who had individual lives and hopes and dreams, and everything that we take for granted has been lost in this awful atrocity.
20,000 students have a chance to visit each year. Many explore The Journey, a permanent exhibition charting the journey of children through the Holocaust that was opened in 2008. And then each child has a chance to listen to a Holocaust survivor.
When young people hear and meet a survivor, that brings our history into reality.
In years to come, when we see stuff like genocide happen again, it will help us think more into what is a country we need to do about it, because it's unfair.
In the 1990s, more than 6 million civilians died as a result of ethnic conflict and genocide. And so the centre's sister organisation, the Aegis Trust for Genocide Prevention, was born.
Mass atrocities didn't stop with the Holocaust, and even as the Holocaust Centre here was being built as a warning from history, Tutsis were being killed in Rwanda, Bosnian Muslims were being killed in Srebrenica, and the processes that lead to genocide and mass atrocities are predictable. And therefore we can all play a role in making them preventable.
In 2002, the Holocaust Centre was visited by senior Rwandan officials.
The Holocaust Centre was very inspiring. I had never seen something like that, and it kicked off the idea to create a more meaningful memorial in Rwanda.
They invited Aegis to establish the Kigali Genocide Memorial. Modelled in its approach on the Holocaust Centre, it's a place of memory where 250,000 victims of the 1994 genocide are buried. It's also a place of learning for young Rwandans and the international community.
In creating the Holocaust Centre, we hoped that while it might not be an enjoyable experience for visitors, it would be a valuable one.
It's a warning to society to take note, but it's still going on. So people have learned very little. By and large, little has been learned from history.
But what we wanted to do is raise the question in people's minds, what am I actually going to do?
When you've heard me speak, when you've been round this magnificent, interesting place, go home.
So I hope that gives a bit of a background between the relationship between the National Holocaust Centre in the UK and here in the Genocide Memorial. And we know as time goes by, a lot of the challenges and themes that we have are much in common about how history is denied, how it's distorted, and how there's an ongoing threat of the ideas that lead to this violence in the first place that we all have some responsibility to address. But I want to hand over now to our friends and colleagues from Yeshiva University, from the Emil Fisch Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies. First, I will introduce Dr. Shai Pilnik, who is the executive director of the center, who will tell us a little bit more about what you do, and will also introduce our really honored guest at Emil Fisch, and we're really, again, so grateful to have the opportunity to meet you, Emil, today.
Thank you, James. We are actually thankful to you and to Freddie and to our new friends in Rwanda for this invitation. Thank you for coming here. If I will share with you quickly the story of what brought us here. It's an interesting story. When I became the director of our center, I decided that it's about time. I was feeling that people are starting now to forget the Holocaust. It's been decades. My grandparents survived the Holocaust. I have three grandparents who were Holocaust survivors, and I grew up with them. And in a way, their stories were, as they say in English, the soundtrack of my life. You know, I spent time with them growing up. Now I had children, and my children knew only one grandparent, but vaguely knew her. My grandmother didn't speak English. My children spoke only English, and I started to see that people in America were forgetting the Holocaust. We said, don't ever forget, never forget, never again. But the fading of memory was in front of my eyes. So I came up with an idea. Let's start to look for the people who are our allies in the field of Holocaust education. The people who fight the good fight, the people who dedicate their lives to Holocaust education. And I thought that I would find them in the most unusual places. So I started a series of videos. This was also during COVID. We could only do business via Zoom. And I decided this to launch a series of Zoom programs called Holocaust Remembrance Around the World. Every month, we would look for an ally who is doing incredible work in Holocaust education in the most unusual places. A student of mine, a woman named Lois Roman, helped me to pull this off together. And we started to speak with people in South Africa, Australia, Poland, Germany, the Dominican Republic, and then Rwanda. I was told that there is a person named Freddy Mutangwa that I have to meet. So we had, actually, I recommend that you go later to our website and you watch our 50-minute conversation. And I have to say that this meeting changed the way I look at Holocaust education and changed my life. What I learned from Freddy is that the story of the Holocaust can be incredibly meaningful in a different context. And I'm going back to what Mark said before. The context is different. Every story is unique. We have an obligation to learn the story of the genocide in Rwanda. When I say we, I mean our students at Yeshiva University, the Jewish community in America, Jews around the world, and of course humanity at large. It's a unique story. The story of the Jewish people is also a unique story. But when you want to learn how genocide evolves and what the process that brings genocide from A to Z, the patterns, as Mark said before, the patterns are the same. The process is the same. The circumstances are different. What blew my mind was that Freddy did not talk about the Rwandan genocide until Freddy visited Yad Vashem. Remember? And Freddy insisted to play a soundbite from Elie Wiesel. And I was trying to tell you, Freddy, we're here to talk about the Rwandan genocide. And you said, no, this is about the Rwandan genocide. I have to play the soundbite from Elie Wiesel. Elie Wiesel was a Holocaust survivor who talked about the incredible lesson, the incredible duty, the commitment we all need to have to remember. So Freddy, you learned something from the Holocaust of the Jewish people that's incredible. And Emil Fish, whom I will introduce to you, Emil is the founder of our center. I'm the director of a center named after Emil and his late wife. Emil survived the Holocaust as a child. I have to say, the story of Emil's survival is a miracle, but Emil is a miraculous man. I don't know where he takes his energies from. We came from New York City on Sunday, me and his two grandchildren, and I'm in my mid-40s, his grandchildren are in their 20s, and we're all exhausted. The only one who is not exhausted is this 87-year-old man, who is always, yeah. Emil's life can be summarized in two words. What's next? Right? Question mark. Always looking for what to do. What are we going to do? And when I talked to Emil about Freddy and I told him that for International Holocaust Remembrance Day, we have an invitation from Kigali, Emil's immediate response, not even thinking, was, we're going there. We are going to Kigali. We're going to Rwanda. That's the reason why I'm here. So Freddy learned something about the Holocaust of the Jewish people, about how much for Jews, and I think this is in our DNA, how much remembrance is important. Judaism, by the way, is all about memory, is all about remembrance, because our people for 2,000 years have been far apart from each other. The story of the Jewish people, I don't think, can be explained rationally. How come with no internet, no telephone, no TV, Jews developed a very similar culture in different parts of the world and have been in touch with each other? You know, when you bring together in Israel, in 1948, when Israel was created, it brought together Jews from all over the world. And you have Jews from Yemen, from Morocco, from Lithuania, from Germany, from Kazakhstan, all of a sudden living together. It's amazing that in the grand scheme of things, our practices, customs, our faith, it's pretty much the same. What kept us together is the memory that we, for 2,000 years, that we have a bond, we have faith in Hashem, in our God, and we have a covenant with him that he promised us the land of Israel and future redemption. So for Jews, memory is not only memory of the bad things, the bad parts, it's also a memory of the good parts. And in a way, they go together. There are two sides, two flip sides of the same coin. Memory of atrocity. We have to remember the Egyptians who enslaved us in Egypt. That's the story told, by the way, when we read the portion of the Torah right now in the book of Exodus. We have to remember the Egyptians. We have to remember the Amalekites. We have to remember all of our oppressors up to Hitler. So I think memory and remembrance was what Freddie could take from the story of the Jewish people. But only yesterday, when we came to the Kigali Memorial, I think Emil and I finally understood what we can take from you, what lesson we are learning here. What we are learning, and Emil, I think, would want to share his own point of view and elaborate it, and elaborate on it in a minute, is that after the Holocaust, Jews came from the camps and exclaimed, "Never again. We will dedicate our lives that something so terrible will never happen to us and never happen to any human being." And if you think about it, the whole concept of the international community, the infrastructure of the international community is all based on that concept. The United Nations, human rights organizations, peacekeeping, even the term genocide, by the way, was a term coined by a Holocaust survivor, by Raphael Lemkin, who was a lawyer, a Jewish lawyer, who came up with a new definition for a crime that he believed was a new crime that remained nameless. So think about all the things we have done. We came up with the concept of international community. We came up with the concept of genocide as the crime of crimes. We came up with institutions and infrastructure that would ensure that, first of all, people will never do such a thing to each other. And second, if that happens, the international community would intervene. The third party would intervene. So we did everything. We, as humanity, we had done anything we could to ensure that it doesn't happen again. And then we learn that it did happen here. That in 1994, 1 million people, close to 1 million people were killed in 100 days, which is a very sad proof that in a way, never again is still a theory. Never again is a theory, but it's not a practice. For me as an educator, by the way, interacting with my own people, with Jews, it's very hard to convince them sometimes that this is still a valid danger. That yes, Hitler is already dead. He's been dead for more than 80 years, close to 80 years. But the supporters of Hitler are still alive. But he has many supporters and unfortunately a growing number. And that this danger is still alive. The danger is alive and kicking and is still there. Now the question is, what do we do? What do we do about it? And I have to say that the response to genocide has to be multifaceted. We have to respond on many levels. I like the name Aegis Trust. James shared with me that Aegis in ancient Greek means to protect, right? So when we think about protection, how do we prevent genocide? We prevent genocide by building a military infrastructure. We need to have a strong army. It's all good. We need to have a strong military. We need to fund institutions that would help protect people. But when all is said and done, the most cost-effective, if you think about it, the cheapest, most cost-effective, most durable, and most powerful investment is in education. It's to educate young people. That's the and as you know, in medicine, preemptive care is always cheaper than to care for sick patients. Sometimes I know when people look at Emil Fish and his work, my work too, they wonder, why are you doing this? It's crazy, genocide, you know. Do something good, you know, talk about the environment, talk about helping the poor, helping the elderly. Why genocide? But we believe that this is the kind of maintenance work that we have to do, so we never get to the point that our job becomes acute. Our job becomes to respond to an actual genocide. And it all begins with education, especially education of young people whose brains are still shapeable. I want to share with you a final reflection. The purpose of the Nazis, and I believe that that was also the purpose of the Hutu genocidaires, it's actually the purpose of all people who commit genocide. Their purpose was to build a better world, believe it or not. To build a better world in accordance with their own sick minds. Adolf Hitler imagined that after all the Jews are killed, Germany would experience a tremendous renaissance. He thought that Germany would become what he called the 1,000-year Reich. It will be a country that will survive for 1,000 years. It will be a great empire. The people who commit genocide do it always out of fear. I'm going back to Mark. The same patterns. They do it out of fear, and they do it because they believe that if we don't kill, we're going to be killed. Believe it or not, but Joseph Goebbels, who was second to Hitler in the Nazi hierarchy, wrote in his diaries towards the end of the war, if we don't finish killing the Jews, they will kill us. Even though Jews had no military, no army, they were helpless people, individuals. So the people who commit genocide have this dream, imaginary dream of a better world. But what they do, always what they do, they both destroy and self-destroy. They always lead to destruction and to self-destruction. When I teach young people about the Holocaust, there is one image that I love showing them. And that's the image of any ordinary city in Germany in 1945 and what it would look like, and what it looked like. I want to show you, I want to show the students, the hatred destroyed the Jewish people, but it also destroyed the Germans. Every city in Germany was destroyed. So we cannot build a better world based on the ideas of Hitler, based on the ideas of the Hutu genocidaires. The only way we can build a better world is if we build a diverse society in which people of different cultures, races, ethnic groups live alongside each other, celebrate their difference. You know, Jews are a minority. We're a minority everywhere except for Israel. We celebrate our differences and we learn how to respect each other. And true, this is very difficult. It's a very difficult task. Some would say that the multicultural society, the pluralistic society, doesn't really work anywhere around the world. But the news I'd like to share with you is that we have no choice. And if we do not get used to the idea of living together and respecting each other, what we're going to get instead is the dead bodies of hundreds of thousands of people. So I wanted to thank you for being such great listeners. We're going to move on with the program. And if there's anything we can do to continue this partnership, we would be so grateful. In a way, our friendship between Jews and Rwandans, between the Fish Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies and you, it's really about the best and worst experiences in the human condition. It's about memories of what human beings can be at the worst and what human beings can also be at their best when they interact with each other, learn about each other, and show towards each other tremendous respect. So thank you. Now let's move on to the more interesting part of the program. So Emil, you're going to share your testimony tomorrow. But maybe you can share with this group, oh, I see they are bringing you a podium. Would you like to stand instead? Yes, yes. So it's actually good. We can... Oh, better like that. Can you see Emil? As long as you can see Emil. He was just concerned that if he doesn't stand, you can't see him. Okay. So Emil, share with us a few details about the story of your survival, where you're from. You will give the longer version tomorrow.
Thank you very much. First of all, I want to thank James and Freddie for inviting me. And I wish my mother would be alive and she would believe everything you said and everything you said about me. I guarantee you she would believe every word. Yes, and I have a disadvantage. I don't speak English with an English accent, and I don't speak English with an American accent. I guess I speak English in my own accent. So I hope you understand. So I'm going to try to make the story as short as possible, okay? It's really a story of a Jewish family who were running away ahead of the Nazis being caught, because their intent was to kill every Jew. So it wasn't a question how you look or how religious you were. If you were a Jew, we're going to kill you. So every Jew was trying to run away from being caught and sent to concentration camp. That was the intention. There was about 11 million Jews, and they were going to kill every one of them, and they succeeded in 6 million. And the rest of it, they killed gypsies, black people, homosexuals, Jehovah's Witnesses, anybody who wasn't blonde, blue eyes, they basically were going to kill. So that's the lesson that you were talking about. It, in order to survive, you basically had to have luck and money, physical strength, faith in God, and so on and so on. So I'm not going to go all the attributes that you had to have in order to survive. But every Holocaust person has a story. My story is unique to me. It's not unique to the Holocaust survivor. In order to survive, you had to have your own story. You have your own story. Some of them are even better than mine, believe it or not. So I was born in a very Orthodox religious home in a town, 10,000 people in Slovakia, of which 3,000 were Jews, and they lived together for maybe 150, 200 years, and the Germans killed 80% of us, and 20% were stayed alive. We were always discriminated, so I grew up being discriminated. It was nothing new to me. We would not go alone in the street because the Gentiles would beat us up, and we tried to avoid alleys, and we tried to go in two guys together, so one guy is not going to fight two. And I had an interesting story. I had a wild cousin from another town, and he was really wild, strong and big. And when he came to town, the kids never fought with us. They were afraid that he's going to retaliate. We had to attend Jewish school in the afternoon. In the morning, the law said you had to attend public school, so we were discriminated all the time. So raised as an Orthodox Jew, I couldn't write on Sabbath, so the teacher had made us sit in the back room, because you're Jewish, you're different, and you're not going to write on Sabbath, you're going to sit in the back. So discrimination is just part of my life. And the reason that we were not deported is because the economy had exemptions to people who they needed for the economy. My father was a very smart businessman, and he manufactured railroad ties, and the Germans needed railroads, and they needed ties. So he got exemption to be deported in the first transport, which was in 1942. In 42, they took away 80% of the population, including all my relatives, except my father and my sister and my mother. And 10% of the people got exemption because they were needed in the economy. Nobody came back from my father's side except him. So if you think it's unusual, it's very unusual. Nobody, no cousins, no grandfathers, no aunts, except him. He was the only survivor from my father's side. From my mother's side, we were luckier. Most of them did survive. After 44, 2 years later, the Germans decided to kill every Jew and take all the exemption. In 42, they sent out 80%. In 44, they took the rest of us. So everybody went into hiding, running to another country. And everybody had their own plan how to survive. There was no general plan. There was no idea. Some lived in forests far away from the Nazis. We decided to go to a big city under Aryan papers, which means false papers. And many times they caught us and we talked ourselves out of it. So I'm not going to give you the details. But I will tell you something that I usually, I don't even have in my speech. My father went to Germany to school, so he spoke German perfect. And one of the places, we came in with a train to a capital and we had to have breakfast. We walked in a restaurant in 44 and there was only one table available there and a German officer was there and we looked Jewish, more or less. But my father spoke perfect German and he had no way how to get out of this thing. We had to sit down. So just to give you an example that you have to do everything you possibly can to survive. That's how you survive. My father told us quietly in Jewish, Yiddish, please do not talk when we sit down. My father sat down. He didn't look German. He didn't look Slovakian. He raised his hand and he told the German officer sitting at the table by himself, "Hi, Hitler." German officer jumped up, gave him back, "Hi, Hitler." Oh, I couldn't figure out that one. I said, this is the end of it. And my father said to him, "You know what? I don't like you. You are occupying Slovakia now. They didn't occupy him for many years. And we don't like occupation. We know what to do with the Jews. We need to kill them. That's what we need to do. We don't need you Germans' help. We know what to do. They are bad people, and we're going to kill them all. And you are occupying us, and we don't like you. We don't like occupation. We know what to do." The poor German officer was angry at my father. He didn't know what to tell him. He got up. He said, "Hi, Hitler." My father got up, said, "Hi, Hitler." The German left the table, and we had breakfast. That's how people survived. Everybody had to figure it out on his own. Okay, so we finally were hiding. To make a long story short, we got caught by the Gestapo one night in 44. They gave an order that every Gentile who hides Jews is going to get killed. All the Gentiles were afraid. So within 2 days, they arrested like 2,000 people in capital, and our family is one of them. My father was sent to Buchenwald, which is a German, one of the German camps, and we were supposed to send to Auschwitz. By that time, the trains didn't work in Germany, and we were sent to Bergen-Belsen. He went to Buchenwald, my father, my mother, and my sister went to Bergen-Belsen, and that time, typhus, diseases, overpopulation, and there were no gas chambers there, but just dying from health reasons and food. And there were thousands of people lying dead. And the Germans didn't know what to do with us, with the dead people. And that's how we grew up It just happens to be that my neighbor was Anne Frank. I don't remember her, so don't ask me questions about her. She became famous after that. She did not survive typhus. Her sister Margot did not survive. My sister got typhus. She did survive. And in April 15, we were liberated by the English. And the English had no idea what to do with us. They came up there, and they saw all these dead bodies. They had no idea. So finally, of course, they had to feed us. So they fed us water and food. There's 10,000 of us died immediately because we were so skinny. We weren't that skinny. I wasn't that skinny myself, but most of the people were skinny, and they died from too much eating. Till they took them a few weeks, the English recognized this is not going to work. So they called England. There was a military occupation, and they told the health department in England, this is not going to work. So they sent experts, and they figured out no food. They had to give us water slowly and take us to hospital. So my sister was taken to hospital, and they fed us little by little. And she survived, and the occupation, they started burying the people, and they had no solution what to do with the camp. Because of typhus, they burned the whole camp to prevent typhus spreading. So Bergen-Belsen has no buildings. I don't know if you realize that. All it is a field, and they had no solution. They never heard such a thing. General Eisenhower, who did not want to visit the camp, and he was the general who won the war, supposedly, with the English one, and he was not going to visit the camp, and he was finally persuaded to come to Bergen-Belsen. He came in, he vomited. Can you believe the general who won the war vomited? He couldn't handle it. He couldn't believe it, what was going on. So that's how we survived, and we came back to Slovakia, and my father survived, thanks God, and my mother and sister, and we continue having a normal life till 48, the communists came, then we left. Every Jew left whenever somebody would accept them. Even then, they would not accept Jews after the war. That quarter, including America, a lot of people went to Canada, South America, and I went to Israel to study as a teenager. My parents went to Canada, but Canada was more liberal. So that's how we survived. The rest of it is just a typical American story. I studied engineering, went to school, went in business. I'm a businessman. I'm not a speaker. I don't talk philosophy. I leave it up to Shai. And I lived the American dream. I had a child, 12 grandchildren. And one day I visited my hometown, and I realized that I'm going to give up my business, and I'm going to concentrate on teaching Holocaust. That shouldn't happen again. And that's what I've been doing for 20 years, last 20 years, and I give up half of my business. I've helped, but I don't run it, basically. And that's my purpose in life. Thank you for listening.
Freddie, do we have time for a question for Emil and then some questions from the students? So Emil, what is your biggest takeaway from this visit to Rwanda? We talked about it before.
So I like to have eye contact with people. So, you know, I came to Rwanda when I knew the story more or less. You know, everybody knows the story. When I was told that we were invited to Rwanda, I said, I don't care what the story is, I'm going. Because the similarity. And so I expected meet nice people like you are, and we're going to learn from each other, and we're going to do things together. But that's not what I learned. Not at all. The only thing I learned from my whole trip is two words. Never again is a dream. That's all it is. It's going to happen again. It happened here. Going to happen again and again and again till education, to the educated people, what Shriver's talking about, that we all have to live together. It makes absolutely a difference how you look, how, what you do, because everybody has the same dream. Every mother has the same dream. Shelter for the kid, clothes, and food. And that's what we need. And everything else is superfluous. It's okay, but don't pay attention. Just live together. So never again is a dream.
Thank you. James.
Thank you. Emil, we saw on this short film some images of the concentration camp Bergen-Belsen. I don't know whether everybody connected that. Bergen-Belsen was the pictures where we saw piles of bodies, of corpses of Jewish people that were being pushed into a big hole by with a bulldozer. And Emil, I think you were probably 9 or 10 years old when you were taken to that camp. You described this camp with your mother and your sister. What my question is did you witness those particular scenes? And if so, as a young boy and through your teenage years, 20 years, how does that memory affect you? You must be incredibly resilient not to be living with nightmares after, you know, it's one thing as seeing this on a film, but you were there, and this was your people, this could have been you. How do you recover from that?
You know, this is a very good question, but you asked me if I witnessed it. We lived in barracks, like army barracks, not as nice, obviously, there was no bathrooms. But when I got out of my door, across there was about a 10-acre, what is it, 40 dunams land, full of corpses, 3 feet high. That's when I opened the door, I saw. It just happens to be that our barrack was across that field. There were many fields like this. So human being has an instinct, and I don't want to talk philosophy of survival. You'd be surprised what people can take as far as hunger, people who didn't eat for a week, 2, 3, and they still survive. And so survival takes over, and you stop thinking. But I tell you one thing that you don't hear more very often. Most people who survived had a friend with them as a friend. You almost had to have a friend to survive. You had to 2 friends. Because if you lost your cup, you couldn't buy another cup. So you had to share a cup. And if you didn't have a spoon, they didn't go to a store and say, hey, let me have another spoon. You ate without a spoon. So now you have a friend. So you almost had to, people who survived had some friends, 1 or 2 friends that they suffered together and they're for each other. It's very interesting. You would think that being selfish works. It doesn't. It doesn't. It doesn't work. So survival became the most important thing, and a lot of things you do that you wouldn't think normal people do, but we had to do.
Do we want to open it up for questions now from the audience? If you can introduce yourself when you ask questions.
Thank you, Mutano Sedorin. And my question, before asking it, I have to thank you for being strong enough to tell us about your story. My question is, you say that you committed yourself to teach the Holocaust, and I'm asking myself, what is the force? What pushes you to keep on going through all those history that you passed through without having any problem? Like, if you are committing yourself to teach students and other young people or other people, if you commit yourself to teach them about the Holocaust, it's like you're revisiting your history.
What you relive it. You in a way relive the memories.
Yeah.
You understood
what
the question?
So, great question.
I have a few problems in life that I'm not going to share with you. One of them, I'm a sour loser. I hate to lose. And it was true when I was playing tennis, when I was playing soccer, I'm a terrible loser. And I have some grandkids, some of them are terrible losers too, some of them are okay, but I'm a terrible loser. So when I came to my hometown, there were no Jews there. Out of the 3,000 Jews, there were no Jews left, but there were buildings. The synagogue is intact, and luckily, the community buildings were there, in more or less intact. But they were used as warehouses, and so I realized that Hitler killed the Jews and is winning the war of heritage. But I can't do anything about my grandparents, but I can do something about the heritage. So I wouldn't let him win the war. That's what drove me. No philosophy, no thinking much. I just told myself, he killed the Jews, but he's not going to kill my religion. So I start restoring the town. And everybody was against me for years, but I didn't give up. Because there's no interest restoring heritage in a town where there are no Jews. But now it's in style because people realize that heritage is just as important as money. So I committed myself to restore the heritage of that town. So one of the things, and I wrote a book that I shared, one of the things that I realized, remember, I'm not a scholar. I can't teach philosophy. But the Jews who died didn't have a grave. They don't have a stone. Jewish people put a stone on a grave. So I built a monument there against a lot of people's wishes with everybody's name on that monument and their birthday. And I said, that's their grave. And that's what it is. So there's no big philosophy about it. It's just, I'm a bad loser. I wouldn't let Hitler win the whole war. And he's losing it, obviously.
Wow, so powerful. More questions.
Thank you so much. My name is Christian Inwari, and I'm the director of a youth led organization called Our Past Initiative. And some of our objectives is to teach the young people, mostly those who were born after the genocide, about the history, and also involve them in activities to help the genocide survivors. So my question is, when did you ever talk about your history with your kids? At what age? The reason why I'm asking this question is because we have a very, very huge gap between our parents and the young generation. And sometimes the answers we get is because the parents don't want their kids to go the same trauma they went through. And two, the kids don't know how to ask because they never had the chance to talk with their parents on that specific issue. So my question is, what advice would you give to the Rwandan survivors? And I think that's the key, because if you don't want it to happen again, we need to talk about it as much as we can. Thank you.
Wow, what a powerful question.
So my kids, the survivors of the Holocaust Center, I don't know what the custom is here. I haven't been long enough to talk to people. Did not talk about the Holocaust. The survivors, my father never talked about the Holocaust, but I did catch him once in a while cry by himself. So I wasn't interested in the Holocaust at all. That was the, I hate to say that, but a lot of Jewish people in America and the world don't care about the Holocaust as a history. They know it happened, and their parents disappeared, the family, they go on with their life. And so did I. But it became more stylish to talk about the Holocaust. So 2004, my kids, three kids, said, you know what? Everybody is going on a heritage tour to Europe, and you never take us anything. You take us skiing, we go to Hawaii, we do all the things the American kids do, and you don't take us any place. And I said, well, I have a dream. I like to go to Germany, but I like to go in an open plane with no bottom, take a few bombs, drop them, and then run away. That's my dream. But it's not going to happen. I can't buy a plane. Nobody's going to sell me one, especially after 9/11. You know, you can't get a plane so easy. So I'm not going to do that. So leave it alone. So finally, they convinced me it's not fair. You got to take us. So I took them for a Holocaust heritage tour. And the heritage tour is usually made up of the same thing. You take your kids to the hometown where you came from. You show them where your parents live, where you went to school. And there are no Jews most of the time there. And the taxi driver waits for you for the whole day, and you leave at 4 o'clock. And that's it. And you show them the synagogue and the school where you went to school, and you leave. There are no hotels in these small towns. And that's exactly what I had in plan, except it didn't work out this way. Because the minute I came, the taxi driver, I have no idea why. Yes, the mayor wants to see you. So I said, how does he know that I'm coming? He said, I have no idea. I have an order to bring you to the mayor's office. We had a nice conversation. And then I went to see the places, right? That's what I came for. So one place was a Home Depot store, which is a building supply store, and it was closed, couldn't get in. Another synagogue was an office building, couldn't get in. So the only thing I could get in is the cemetery, and that was overgrown. So my first visit, I did nothing. I saw nothing. So I came back half a year later, and of course I made an arrangement. I made sure that all the buildings are open. And I saw, and what drove me crazy is they opened the synagogue, beautiful synagogue, not what you think of a synagogue. It's little, and there were used toilets stored there where I prayed as a child. It drove me crazy, you know? And so I said, that ain't going to happen anymore. So it took me years to change it because nobody would cooperate. But it's a school, so that's a last 10 years, but 23 years ago, nobody cared. Am I saying that correctly?
And I will add, I want to see if James has anything to mention, to add. I wanted to add that sometimes in order to share stories with the younger generation, transmit them from parents to children, you need to wait for the right climate, the right atmosphere. And the atmosphere changes, and it's not just up to you. Today in America, and in Israel too, I am originally from Israel, it is a lot more acceptable to speak about the Holocaust. Young people are actually eager to come to their grandparents and to ask them, tell me what happened, if the grandparents are still alive. Sometimes it's the children of survivors who now tell the stories of their deceased grandparents who are no longer alive. In 1958, 1955, 10 years after the end of World War II, you could hear the most powerful stories for people who had fresh memories, people who were survivors, who survived the war as adults. They were in their 30s, in their 40s, people who had children. Nobody spoke at that time. You know, it was only in the trial of Adolf Eichmann in 1961 that the first story started to come out. I can even tell you that growing up in Israel, being a grandson of survivors, I felt comfortable asking them about what happened only when they were already in their 90s, if they were alive. So sometimes I think it's not necessarily in your control, but if you feel that the atmosphere is not ready, there will be a point, there will come a point when the children and grandchildren will come and say, Daddy, Grandma, tell me what happened.
was a great question and wonderful answers from Emil and Shai. I would add that having spoken with hundreds of Holocaust survivors at the UK's National Holocaust Centre over the years and seen how some also struggle to talk to their children, more so their grandchildren, but and for the different reasons challenged, and part of it was about just rebuilding their lives and having to pay for the rent and food and get a job and all learn new language and so. But what I would add is that if as a survivor you feel it's not the right time for your children or for your community in terms of the environment, do try to record your stories. Try to make a note, whether it's some handwritten notes, whether it's typed on a laptop, or whether it's recorded into an audio recorder or a video or some other documentation. Try and do your best to record that, because later your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren will really appreciate that. And I've seen that over and again, that there will be a hunger to know, even if it's hard to try to do that. Then Mark, you had a question. Yeah, sorry, was that a question? Mark, do you want to go? I don't know how much time we've got. Do you want to go first and then Mark? Yes. Yeah, you go.
Thank you so much. My name is Parfine from Peace and Love Proclaimers. So I'm individually a person very keen to details, and unfortunately the testimony was very short for me, so I really hope we get to get more details tomorrow, what you felt then, how you got to forgive and also move on. So my question goes around education and how you got to deal with unity and also forgiveness, and what are the gaps you've identified so far that makes this never again just a theory for now?
Mind repeating the question?
Okay, so I'm asking, what are the gaps you've identified so far in education that makes this never again a theory just for now?
Fantastic. Okay, so she was saying that she would like to get more details. Your testimony was very short, and I would add that you can find actually the longer version on it, and I'll be happy to direct you. But the question about, you mentioned the fact that never again is a dream and not a reality. And she wants to know what's missing in order to make it a reality.
Well, you know, it's a very complicated question, because the Jewish people, I don't want to compete with you, the Jewish people survived. They are known as the people of the book. I don't know your background and your education, so I apologize. So the key is education. That's how Jewish people survived. Am I correct? It's all about education. So you need to teach your kids and your friends the education of the what happened here, what happened in the Holocaust, in a way that it doesn't solve the problem. It's a waste of time. And you know from your private life that you don't want to waste your time. Right? If you have free time, you go to a movie, you see your friend, you study, but you most, in America at least, we don't waste time. I don't know, it's a culture or whatever it is. So education is the key. Why? Why education? Because when you have money, you can lose it. And when you're good looking, you can become ugly. And when you're fat, you can be skinny, or the other way around. But you can't take away your education. It's something that you invest, and nobody can take it away from you. So that's the answer.
Okay, and we have time for two more questions. Do we have any more questions?
up on your question and your answer, Emil. You said before the Holocaust, as a child, you had Slovak, non-Jewish Slovakians who would want to beat you up. Is that better?
Further away?
Right. Sorry. The point about education. You said that before the Holocaust, non-Jewish Slovakians would want to beat you up. And you said after the Holocaust, back in Slovakia, no one wanted to collaborate with you to revive the Jewish heritage because no Jews there. Should all genocide education be more about the why, not just the what of the atrocity?
So when I came to that little town, I had the same question. Well, how are we going to do this? You know, educating the Jewish kid isn't going to work, right? So we created a contest in high school where they write a contest. We have a celebration every year. Some of it is televised. Every year, we have a commemoration where I bring people from all over the world. They paid their way, and we have a ceremony, just like now. We do that, and we have a contest of the high school kids, and we give them prizes, and you should see what they wrote. These are non-Jews. You wouldn't believe it. You know. And then I was so happy, I created contents in pictures, in drawings. Well, how they imagined the Jews lived before they were born. The book is going to be published in a few months, I hope. You'll see pictures there. So I started education of the non-Jews in the town so they should know. And that, so you can't just contain it in the Jews. That doesn't help. You know, you have to educate the people, and they're very active, and they surprised me every time I come there. Usually I don't go every year, but I go every second year. But they have a commemoration of every year with diplomats, people from. It's a small town, but it's very well known historically, and they do their own. Education. It's non-Jews.
Okay, we have two more questions, yes.
Good afternoon, my name is Giselle Sandrine, and I have two questions that I would like to ask, and they're also in line with intergenerational trauma. I'm a researcher, and my first question is, it's been over 80 years, and I've been wondering, and it's the same also question that drives me through my research that I do, and how do the youth of today, or maybe the generation of today, because it's been over 80 years after the Holocaust, how do generations after generation understand or maybe define the identity of commemoration after all these years? And my second question is, it's with no doubt that there should be effects of the Holocaust from the intergenerational trauma perspective. So what are the effects of the Holocaust from generation to generation that keep prevailing as years go by, and how from the survivor perspective and the educator perspective, how do you see it? How do you define them? For instance, we see the feelings of prevail of revenge or maybe justice, if we may say. But I would like to understand the effects that prevail from the intergenerational perspective. Thank you.
Yes.
So education is goes two ways. So we do have all kinds of programs with non-Jews in the town. And most people don't realize that there are a lot of Christians who helped Jews during the war. to survive at their own risk. You always talk about the Germans killing, but very few little people are talk. Yad Vashem, of course, gives a lot of Christians who risk their life to save Jews, including Weber Hiving. I didn't tell you the whole story because of timing, but we were hiding in a Christian in an attic for 3 months. And they gave us food and clothing at the risk of losing their life every day. So what do we do now? Yad Vashem does it better than we do. We give recognition of the community who helped the Jews, and we get them in the mayor talks, and the city is involved, the city hall, and they get involved in the two-way.
Any library. There are dozens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of books about the subject. So we do notice that to some degree there's also hope that there is more and more public interest in the subject. Now you asked before the question, you also asked the question about intergenerational trauma. And there are studies that show that sometimes children of Holocaust survivors have more effects and side effects of the Holocaust compared to their parents who've experienced it. Somebody even did a study that showed that grandchildren of survivors tend to have more anxiety, tend to deal with anxiety, with depression, at rates that are higher, much higher, than the rest of the population. I once met a child of a Holocaust survivor who shared with me the following statement, which I found to be very powerful. He said, "The most important moment of my life happened 5 years before I was born." In other words, that the Holocaust was for him such a powerful experience on his life, even though it all happened, you know, before he was even conceived. And true, we have to remember that I can share with you as a professional who works in the field that I deal with a lot of volunteers and donors and teachers and educators who have been scarred by the experience. Sometimes it's not easy necessarily to deal with them. But I remember that working with a population that's been traumatized, and maybe I understand it because my own community, my own family has gone through the same trauma, that interacting with these people and helping them is a part of my mission. It's not just to offer education. It's also to be able to engage a population of people who suffered such severe trauma. You have to recognize the fact that the trauma doesn't go away.
Make it very short. Whenever I have 3 kids, whenever I tell them, "You're doing something wrong, don't do it," and I criticize, they tell me the same thing. "Don't blame me, I'm a child of a Holocaust survivor." That's it. And they walk away. And all my grandchildren are starting to say that. If they misbehave, they say, "Don't blame me. I'm a grandchild of a Holocaust survivor."
Always spread hate speeches, always ignore what happened here in Rwanda. How do you deal with those people? Thank you.
I'll just say very, very briefly, the phenomenon of denial, I think we all know here, whenever a genocide happens, no, I'll correct that, during the genocide, the denial happens. Because the perpetrators are finding way to confuse and distort what they're doing. And you know, Gregory Stanton, from Genocide Watch, described denial as the final stage of genocide. I think he's adapted that slightly now, but it's a pattern after every genocide. And more so, you know, after the Holocaust, it was a huge, huge issue, as you mentioned. What's happening now, I think it's less. And also here in Rwanda and around the world in relation to the genocide against the Tutsi, it's somehow easier to rebut the the Holocaust didn't happen, or the genocide against the Tutsi didn't happen. What's so much more difficult is the confusion, the distortion that happens, especially on social media. And all I can say is that we have to learn from each other how we combat this. And I know that it's going to come back down to rigorous research, documentation, telling a story, ensuring memorials happen, ensuring it's in the curriculum. But we just have to be not just vigilant, but every time we see it, try and call it out. It's hard to do that. You call it out on social media and all the trolls come after you. But we have to do everything we can. Unfortunately, in relation to the Holocaust, governments are beginning to take part in this as well, even in Poland today. They don't deny that the Holocaust happened. Of course, they preserve the big camps like Auschwitz, and they do a great job on the preservation. But, for example, they don't want to talk about the role that Polish people took part in terms of anti-Semitism. Of course, many Poles, 3 million Poles, were victims of the Nazis, but there was also anti-Jewish sentiment, a lot of anti-Jewish sentiment in Poland, which now, by the way, it's illegal by law that you can't speak about that. So it's becoming a growing problem. Really across Europe and across the world, but I don't know, final word to you, Shai or Emil, on the matter.
To me and Emil, I'm sure Emil would want to add something. I know you, you're going to add something, I'm sure. Okay, the reason why Holocaust deniers, or the deniers of the Rwandan genocide, the reason why they are so powerful and so dangerous is because the design of any genocide is meant to make people not be able to believe. Sorry. To make people not be able to believe that such thing had happened. The murder of Jews, for instance, was so rapid. People were gassed in gas chambers, sometimes 2,000 people within half an hour. The process was so rapid that it meant to look implausible. It meant to look unimaginable. I want to share with you a very powerful statement that one of our students, whose parents survived Auschwitz, shared with me. He said, you know, my father used to tell me, son, sometimes even I believe that it didn't happen. I, who survived Auschwitz, sometimes I cannot believe that this happened. And Holocaust deniers, they thrive on that. That's what feeds them. The danger of dealing with doesn't lie with the Holocaust survivors, but with those who the danger doesn't lie with Holocaust deniers, but rather with those who believe them. And it's, by the way, the same with the Nazis, the same with those who committed the Rwandan genocide. It's a small group of people that becomes very dangerous when they win the hearts, the minds, the ears of the majority. So in education, we always prefer to talk to what could be the silent majority, what could be the bystanders. Talking directly to a denier is sometimes pointless. It's like talking to a member of the Flat Earth Society. You tell them that the Earth is round, and they will come with 10,000 counter-arguments for why the Earth is actually flat. So the problem is not with this fringe, small group of crazy people. The problem is that they find it easy to convince millions that they are right. And why do they do it? They do it when they show, look, something like that is unimaginable. How can you imagine that 6 million people would be killed in such a short period of time? One more comment. The mission of the Nazis, and James mentioned it before, was to forget about the Holocaust, right? The last stage of the Holocaust was destroying the evidence. So when we engage in education, what we really do is we undo the work of the Nazis. It's our obligation. And if we don't engage in education, we in a way double down on what they've done. We help them. And that's why the response to Holocaust denial is so important.
Very final word, quick comment from Mark, and then we'll come to you, Emil.
Thank you. I have a suggestion.
to offer to you and to you for asking the question, which is kind of to build on what everyone has said and kind of not. I think that there is too much emphasis placed, certainly in Holocaust education over the last 5, 6, 7 decades on the simple fact of what happened, with not enough understanding of the motives of the perpetrators. So if I tell you about the amazingly successful movies, books, some even fictitious, they are now unhelpful because they position the fact of the Holocaust as being so fantastical, it's almost like watching a horror movie. It's escapism. Learn from that when you're dealing with your own the story here. Try and help everybody that needs to understand why, because then they have a context to learn from. Otherwise, you're inviting the natural human fascination with morbid, grotesque horror, because it's a fact of human nature. We all gorge on it. It's sensational. That will do nothing to prevent another genocide. It's important to understand human motivations on the perpetrators. So as vital as it is to hear the first person witness testimony of for someone who the victim survived, we need to spend more time, in my view, this is what we do at the Holocaust Museum now in the UK, on the other side of the coin, the perpetrators, and not judging necessarily, understanding. I come from an advertising background. Rule number one, understand your audience. If you want to change attitudes, understand which buttons to hit, which buttons to press. Otherwise, you will never, ever change behavior.
Final word, Emil.
So I have a question. I don't want to be educated. I'm not competing with you guys. So I don't know the audience here. So I'm not going to ask you how many have high schools, how many have college degrees, but I'm going to ask you one question. And I want you raise your hand immediately. Don't think about it. I don't want you to think about it. You just instinctively raise your hand. How many people think there should be no novels written about the Holocaust? No novels. How many think so? Nobody. Wow. Again, how many people think there should be no novels written about the Holocaust? No works of fiction about the Holocaust. Two, three, five. Why? There should be no novels written about the Holocaust, some people think. I'm not going to tell you what I think, because it's such a terrible crime that novels don't tell the story just the way you want to tell it. So if you forbid novels, then the facts are going to come out. With novels, you're confusing people. There should be, a lot of people think intellectuals, there should be a forbidden write novels about the Holocaust. If you want to write about the Holocaust, state no novels. I didn't say I agree or disagree.
It was actually, but it can't be both. James?
I'm going to draw this to a close. There was one final question, actually, that, about the terminology and the definition of genocide here in Rwanda. Rwandan genocide versus genocide against the Tutsi. And just a brief comment on it. It ties a little with your question about denial, of course, for the first decade after the university. So thank you once again. Thank you. Goodbye.